This is a typical hazy day in Beijing. However, this is not the first time the humans have seen it. New Delhi is experiencing it, Los Angeles has seen it, and you probably have heard about the Great Smog of London. It seems inevitable for humans to pollute the nature in the process of economic growth. But does it have to be the case? The greatest challenge facing humanity this century, I'm convinced, is finding the energy to power a civilization of 7 billion people without detrimental consequences to the environment. And I believe renewable energy is front and center in that challenge. The problem with renewable energy is that the supply and demand are not synchronized. For example, here's a profile of wind power over 20 days. As you can see, there are windy days and calm days. And in the same time, human demand follow more of a periodic and regular trend. And obviously, they don't overlap very well. Similarly, for solar, the pattern does not overlap very well with human activities. So this unbalanced supply and demand problem is a major barrier to a wider adoption of renewable energies. So what do we do? And the problem is the electricity price, just like all other commodities, is governed by supply and demand. When renewable energy electricity generation exceeds human demand, like extreme sunny or windy days, the electricity price will actually turn negative, meaning that the utility company is actually paying the customers to use the electricity. Obviously, this is not a healthy market, and it's one of the reasons that utility companies are not investing much in the renewable energy. To solve this unbalanced supply and demand problem, battery storage is the key. But when people usually talk about batteries, they usually mean lithium-ion batteries. Lithium-ion batteries are great, but they're expensive, and they're not really scalable, meaning that they're not really suitable for grid-scale energy storage. They can also be flammable and even explosive. What I've been working on is a new type of battery called flow battery. Flow battery works by storing liquid electrolyte in external tanks. This way, you can arbitrarily scale up or down the size depending on your desired applications, such as storing powers for hospitals or universities. The pumps here are used to flow liquid electrolyte through adjacent half cells separated by this ion exchange membrane. Flow battery is not really a new concept. Traditionally, flow battery employ an inorganic metal ion called vanadium as the electrolyte, and this is what they usually look like in reality. The problem with vanadium is that vanadiums are toxic and they're expensive. More importantly, there's simply not enough vanadium on Earth to support a worldwide energy storage. So I am trained as an organic chemist. So instead of inorganic metal ion, I turn my focus into organic molecules. More specifically, a class of organic molecules called quinones. You may not have noticed, but quinones actually exist everywhere. They're in our dietary supplements, they participate in photosynthesis, they're even responsible for the brownings of apples. So the common roles of quinones in this seemingly unrelated three examples are that quinones store and release electrons in those processes. And that's exactly what we want in a battery, storing and releasing electrons. So inspired by nature, I took the core of these quinone molecules and chemically synthesized several derivatives. One promising candidate stands out, dihydroxybenzoquinone. This molecule is cheap, it's highly water soluble. When I paired this molecule up with iron, I was able to assemble a flow battery with a performance comparable to some of the traditional vanadium flow batteries, but much, much cheaper and safer. One important advantage of using organic molecules instead of inorganic metal ions is that the structures of organic molecules can be modified and the properties can be fine-tuned. Just like adding pieces to a Lego toy, but through chemical synthesis, I was able to add different functional groups onto the molecule to increase its solubility, to improve its stability, or to improve the overall battery voltage. By employing chemical modification, for example, I was able to increase the battery lifetime by more than tenfold. So I've shown you the example of using dihydroxybenzoquinone, and that's a project I've been working on. But more importantly, I want to convey to you the idea of using organic molecules in general as energy storage. My group and I have worked on many different classes of organic molecules, including benzoquinone we just talked about. We've also worked on anthraquinones and other types of quinones. We've also worked on a class of organic molecules called flavones, which is actually a type of vitamins in our body. And obviously, there are more and more other types of organic molecules waiting to be explored, and we are only limited by our imagination. So I want to conclude with a famous quote from former oil minister of Saudi Arabia, Sheikh Yamani. The Stone Age did not end for a lack of stone. An oil age will end long before the world runs out of oil. We are in the time of change, witnessing a gradual shift from fossil fuels to renewable energy. And today, I'm excited to share with you my contribution to a greener and more sustainable future. Thank you.